Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Entrepreneurial State, Debunking Public versus Private Sector Myths by Mariana Mazzucato. Narrated by Callie Beaulieu. Forward to the 2018 edition. Rediscovering Public Wealth Creation. I wrote The Entrepreneurial State in 2013 to combat the view that in order to restore growth after the 2008 financial crisis, all that was needed was to reduce deficits by cutting public spending. Besides reminding listeners that the financial crisis was caused by private debt, not public debt, I argued that it was futile for countries to think they could cut their way to growth, given that a key driver of economic growth has been public investment in areas like education, research, and technological change. Indeed, one of the key lessons in the book is that without strategic public investments, we would not have any of the technologies in our smart products, from the internet to GPS and Siri. We would also not have the renewable energy solutions that might create a green revolution, or most of the radical new drugs to treat diseases. In all these examples, public funds provided the patience and the long-term strategy before business was willing to invest. A greater understanding is thus needed about how to turn this potential capacity of the state as investor of first resort into a key driver of investment-led growth that can help tackle, alongside the private sector, the grand challenges of our time, from climate change to the future of healthcare to shaping the digital revolution. In other words, the book's purpose is to reframe the debate about the state's role in the economy away from ideology and towards practical thinking that can steer economies in ways that addresses societal and technological challenges ahead. The new edition is more relevant now than ever. The U.S. entrepreneurial state is under threat. Even Ronald Reagan, an advocate of downsizing the state, increased funding for the organizations that were key to innovation in pharmaceuticals, informatics, and energy. Today, such organizations are in constant need to defend themselves, not only from downsizing, but from having ambition beyond investing in patchy areas that might facilitate business. Among those in peril is the National Institutes of Health, NIH, which has been responsible for a large percentage of the most radical new drugs on the market, and the U.S. Advanced Research Projects Agency, ENERGY. ARPA-E, the innovation agency inside the Department of Energy, and a sister organization of the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, DARPA, in the Department of Defense. It is indeed curious that the attack on ARPA-E, which is today trying to help lead energy innovation as DARPA-led IT innovation, was one of the first things Donald Trump decided to undertake. Under Trump's first budget proposal, ARPA-E was due to be slashed, but ended up being saved at the last minute. In 2018, it is again under threat, with its $305 million from the DOE's budget under threat and plans to ensure full closure of ARPA-E by mid-2020. While ARPA-E has proven able to take very early stage risks before the private sector is willing, it is being accused of the opposite. There has been concern about the potential for ARPA-E's efforts to overlap with research and development, R&D, being carried out, or which should be carried out, by the private sector. This attack on the very essence and role of public organizations in leading societal and economic change means that the progressive agenda cannot be just about increasing public spending and the fight against austerity. It must also, and especially, be about safeguarding the structures and organizations that have taken time to build and are used to invest in the technology, infrastructure, and services needed for society to work better, to be more sustainable, inclusive, and innovative. While finance for budgets may come and go when organizations are dismantled, they can take decades to reconstruct. This applies equally to organizations that aim to create public value in the areas of modern green transport, next-generation internet, health innovation, or broadcasting. As argued in the book, the spiritual fathers of creative thinking in the public sector include John Maynard Keynes and Karl Polanyi. Keynes called on policymakers to think not just about counter-cyclical spending, but also to think big. In other words, government should not just dig ditches on shovel-ready projects, but think strategically about how investments can help shape citizens' long-term prospects. The economic historian Polanyi went even further in his classic book, The Great Transformation, in which he argued that free markets themselves are products of state intervention. In other words, markets are not freestanding realms in which states can intervene for good or ill. Rather, they are outcomes of public as well as private action. Businesses that make investment decisions and anticipate the emergence of new markets understand the need to think outside the box. Top managers, many of whom see themselves as wealth creators, take courses in decision sciences, strategic management, and organizational behavior. They are encouraged to take risks and to fight against inertia. But if value is created collectively, then those who pursue a career in the public sector should also be taught how to think outside the box and how to be entrepreneurial. But they aren't. Instead, public policymakers and civil servants are not regarded as wealth or market creators, but at best as mere market fixers, enablers and de-riskers, and at worst as impediments to wealth creation. This difference in conception is partly the result of mainstream economic theory, which holds that government should intervene only in cases of market failure. The state's role is to establish and enforce the rules of the game, level the playing field, fund public goods such as infrastructure, defense, and basic research, and devise mechanisms to mitigate negative externalities such as pollution. When states intervene in ways that exceed the mandate to correct market failures, they are often accused of creating market distortions, such as picking winners or crowding out the private sector. Moreover, the emergence of new public management theory, which grew out of public choice theory in the 1980s, led civil servants to believe that they should take up as little space as possible, fearing that government failures may be even worse than market failures, and hence abide by a culture of restraint. This thinking has caused many governments to adapt accounting mechanisms from the private sector, such as cost-benefit analysis, or to outsource functions to the private sector altogether, all in the name of achieving efficiency. Not only is there evidence that outsourcing and privatization more often than not don't lead to greater quality or efficiency, but these trends have undermined confidence in public institutions and have left them ill-equipped to work with businesses to confront 21st century challenges such as climate change and healthcare provision for an aging population. It was not always like this. In the post-war period, two U.S. government agencies, NASA and DARPA, created what would later become the Internet. Both agencies, founded in the 1950s, were given ample funding and clear goals. Their mission-oriented approach allowed them to attract top talent, and their staff were told to think big and take risks. Similarly, ARPA-E, set up in 2009, has been responsible for significant innovations in the field of renewable energy, particularly in battery storage, and the NIH has funded for decades the development of many blockbuster drugs. Rather than learning from the experiences of these programs, especially on how to use policy for tackling societal problems while also nurturing bottom-up experimentation and learning, the opposite is happening. This rich history is forgotten, and mission-oriented public institutions are being weakened. NASA increasingly must justify its existence in terms of immediate economic value rather than the pursuit of bold missions. The BBC is evaluated according to increasingly narrow metrics that are able to justify investments in high-quality news and documentaries, but unable to measure the ambition and success underlying the BBC's key accomplishment, public value creation independent of the format. The creation of public value cannot be simply correcting problems or filling gaps caused by business. Public value can and must become more of an objective in itself, concrete outputs and services that help form a better society, from cleaner air to a digital economy that turns private data not into corporate profits, but into a resource to generate higher quality public services. The process of creating public value is as important as the final output, which ideally would be a result of a dynamic dialogue with civil society through new forms of collaboration between public, private, and voluntary sector organizations and movements at the city, regional, and national level. When mission-driven public sector actors collaborate to tackle large-scale problems, they co-create new markets affecting both the rate of growth and its direction. But co-creating value and directing growth requires experimentation, exploration, and trial and error. And this is why the fixing framework is so misguided. It makes public sector agencies feel like backseat players and renders them more risk-averse, fearing that a failed project might become front-page news. And yet, when successes do happen, such as the investments in the digital technologies, including Google's algorithm, or new forms of energy, or the early stages of biotechnology, they are interpreted as private successes. While market fundamentalists heaped criticism on the U.S. government for funding the solar startup Solyndra, which eventually failed, they never mention the fact that the Tesla S received roughly the same amount of public support. In the 21st century, the debate about growth must become more about its direction and the underlying organizational capacity required to welcome the risk-taking and experimentation needed by all organizations involved. Through this change of mindset, the progressive agenda can be reawakened. It can and should make all actors feel like they are in the driving seat, co-creating value, but also distributing it in more inclusive ways, making it more difficult for a narrow group of self-acclaimed wealth creators to extract value that is created collectively. What is needed is a new dynamic conversation within society on which missions are so vital to our collective futures that we can't afford not to bet on them together. That is the aim of this book. As a matter of fact, capitalist economy is not and cannot be stationary, nor is it merely expanding in a steady manner. It is incessantly being revolutionized from within by new enterprise, i.e., by the intrusion of new commodities or new methods of production or new commercial opportunities into the industrial structure as it exists at any moment. Joseph Schumpeter. Businessmen have a different set of delusions from politicians and need, therefore, different handling. They are, however, much milder than politicians, at the same time allured and terrified by the glare of publicity, easily persuaded to be patriots, perplexed, bemused, indeed terrified, yet only too anxious to take a cheerful view, vain, perhaps, but very unsure of themselves, pathetically responsive to a kind word. You could do anything you liked with them if you would treat them, even the big ones, not as wolves or tigers, but as domestic animals by nature, even though they have been badly brought up and not trained as you would wish. It is a mistake to think that they are more immoral than politicians. If you work them into the surly, obstinate, terrified mood of which domestic animals, wrongly handled, are so capable, the nation's burdens will not get carried to market, and in the end, public opinion will veer their way. John Maynard Keynes. It is a popular error that bureaucracy is less flexible than private enterprise. It may be so in detail, but when large-scale adaptations have to be made, central control is far more flexible. It may take 2 months to get an answer to a letter from a government department, but it takes 20 years for an industry under private enterprise to readjust itself to a fall in demand. Joan Robinson. Where were you guys, venture capitalists, in the 50s and 60s when all the funding had to be done in the basic science? Most of the discoveries that have fueled the industry were created back then. Paul Berg, 1980 Nobel Prize in Chemistry winner. Introduction. Thinking big again. Across the globe, countries, including in the developing world, look to emulate the success of the U.S. economy. In doing so, they look at the power of market-driven mechanisms versus what might seem like old-style state-driven mechanisms in places like Europe or the ex-Soviet Union. But the United States is not what it seems. The preacher of the small state free market doctrine has for decades been directing large public investment programs in technology and innovation that underlie its past and current economic success. From the internet to biotech and even shale gas, the U.S. state has been the key driver of innovation-led growth, willing to invest in the most uncertain phase of the innovation cycle and let business hop on for the easier ride down the way. If the rest of the world wants to emulate the U.S. model, they should do as the United States actually did, not as it says it did. More state, not less. A key part of this lesson should be to learn how to organize, direct, and evaluate state investments so that they can be strategic, flexible, and mission-oriented. Only in this way will top minds find an honor to work for the state. This is something that needs to be understood not only by the rest of the world, but in the United States itself, where the dominant political narrative is endangering funding for future innovation and economic growth. In 2013, U.S. government spending for basic research fell below what it was a decade earlier and will most likely continue to fall due to congressional gridlock over the public budget. Rather than static discussions over the size of the deficit, there must be more debate about its actual composition. How to invest strategically in key areas such as research and development, R&D, education and human capital formation, that will increase gross domestic product, GDP, in the future, bringing the debt to GDP ratio down as a consequence. And how to engage in a debate about the direction of change so that such investments will lead to growth that is not only smarter, innovation-led, but also more inclusive and sustainable. These issues are urgent with the upcoming 2016 U.S. presidential election, which could, if properly informed, change the parameters of the current static debate. The United States desperately needs politicians with the courage to swim against the tide of popular rhetoric and outline a bolder vision for the state's dynamic role in fostering the economic growth of the future. In emerging economies such as China, the public sector is indeed investing billions in new green technologies, with the expectation that these industries will be the engines of future growth. The United States could take inspiration from its own history. In 1961, an American president set out a bold, ambitious, and risky vision to send a man to the moon. Who will have the courage to set out a new vision for America today? Addressing today's societal challenges, for example, those around climate change, require a vision, a mission, and, most of all, confidence about what the state's role in the economy is. As eloquently argued by Keynes in The End of Laissez-Faire, the important thing for government is not to do things which individuals are doing already and to do them a little better or a little worse, but to do those things which at present are not done at all. This, however, requires the public sector to have vision and confidence, increasingly missing today. Why? A discursive battle. What is the role of the public sector in economic growth? After the financial crisis, with public budgets bloated, mainly due to their role in saving the private sector, across the globe, we are hearing that in order for nations to be competitive, innovative, and dynamic, we must have more market and less state. At best, we are told governments merely facilitate the economic dynamism of the private sector. At worst, their lumbering, heavy-handed, and bureaucratic institutions actively inhibit it. The fast-moving, risk-loving, and pioneering private sector, by contrast, is what really drives the type of innovation that creates economic growth. According to this view, the secret behind an engine of innovation like Silicon Valley lies in its entrepreneurs and venture capitalists. The state can intervene in the economy, but only to fix market failures or level the playing field. It can regulate the private sector in order to account for the external cost companies may impose on the public, such as pollution, and it can invest in public goods such as basic scientific research or the development of drugs with little market potential. To some on the political right, even fixing market failures would be a sin because such attempts would lead to a worse outcome in the form of government failures. What all these views have in common is the assumption that the state should stick to fixing markets, not directly trying to create and shape them. A 2012 Economist article on the future of manufacturing encapsulated this common conception. Governments have always been lousy at picking winners, and they are likely to become more so as legions of entrepreneurs and tinkerers swap designs online, turn them into products at home, and market them globally from a garage, the article stated. As the revolution rages, governments should stick to the basics: better schools for a skilled workforce, clear rules, and a level playing field for enterprises of all kinds. Leave the rest to the revolutionaries. This book is committed to dismantling this false image, which underpins a global trend promoted by conservative economists, politicians, and the media, of bashing and diminishing the importance of the state. It focuses on what Tony Judd calls a discursive battle. How we talk about the state matters. Depicting private business as the innovative force, while the state is cast as the inertial one, necessary for the basics but too large and heavy to be the dynamic engine, is a description that can become a self-fulfilling prophecy. If we continue to depict the state as only a facilitator and administrator and tell it to stop dreaming, in the end, that is what we get, and ironically, it also then becomes easier to criticize it for being lame and inefficient. The book argues that the fabricated image of a lazy state and a dynamic private sector is one that has allowed some agents in the economy to describe themselves as the wealth creators, and in doing so, extract an enormous amount of value from the economy in the name of innovation. Indeed, the biggest fall in capital gains tax in U.S. history happened at the end of the 1970s, when the National Venture Capital Association managed to succeed in their lobbying for a 50% fall from 40 to 20% in just 5 years. All on the back of a narrative of the venture capitalists being the true entrepreneurs and risk takers, a story we will see is far from the truth. This biased storyline, describing some actors in the economy as the true innovators, wealth creators, and risk takers, and the others, including the state, as wealth extractors or just distributors, is hurting the possibility of building dynamic and interesting public-private partnerships today. To put it bluntly, this fabricated story hurts innovation and increases inequality, and the problem goes beyond innovation. The story has been used to downsize the state through an increased number of public activities being outsourced to the more dynamic and efficient private sector, chopping away at the very brains of the state, with fewer and fewer resources aimed at building its own internal competencies and capabilities, and reducing what was once a wholesome notion of public value as something to aspire to into a narrow notion of public good, used only to delineate the narrow areas that merit some government intervention, for example, infrastructure, etc. Thinking big. This conventional view of a boring, lethargic state versus a dynamic private sector is as wrong as it is widespread. The book concentrates on telling a very different story, in countries that owe their growth to innovation and in regions within those countries like Silicon Valley. The state has historically served not just as an administrator and regulator of the wealth creation process, but a key actor in it, and often a more daring one, willing to take the risks that businesses won't. This has been true not only in the narrow areas that economists call public goods, like funding of basic research, but across the entire innovation chain, from basic research to applied research, commercialization, and early-stage financing of companies themselves. Such investments, yes, governments invest, not only spend, have proved transformative, creating entirely new markets and sectors, including the internet, nanotechnology, biotechnology, and clean energy. In other words, the state has been key to creating and shaping markets, not only fixing them. Indeed, as is described in one of the longest chapters of the book, Chapter 5, every technology that makes the iPhone smart and not stupid owes its funding to both basic and applied research funded by the state. This, of course, does not mean that Steve Jobs and his team were not crucial to Apple's success, but that ignoring the public side of that story will prevent future Apples from being born. Transformational public investments were often fruits of mission-oriented policies aimed at thinking big, going to the moon or fighting climate change. Getting governments to think big again about innovation is not just about throwing more taxpayer money at more activities. It requires fundamentally reconsidering the traditional role of the state in the economy. In the remainder of this introduction, I delineate what this entails. First, it means empowering governments to envision a direction for technological change and invest in that direction, creating markets, not only fixing them. Different from narrow attempts to identify and pick winners, envisioning a direction for economic development and technical change broadens the technological opportunity landscape and requires that the state creates a network of willing, not necessarily winning, agents that are keen to seize this opportunity through public-private partnerships. Second, it means abandoning the short-sighted way public spending is usually evaluated. Public investment should be measured by its courage in pushing markets into new areas, rather than the usual assumption of an existing market that the public and private actors must bump elbows in, one crowding out the other. Third, it means allowing public organizations to experiment, learn, and even fail. Fourth, precisely because failure is part of the trial and error process of trying to push markets into new areas, it means figuring out ways for governments and taxpayers to reap some of the rewards from the upside, rather than just de-risking the downside. Only once policymakers move past the myths about the state's role in innovation will they stop being, as John Maynard Keynes put it in another era, the slaves of some defunct economist. Creating markets, not only fixing them. According to neoclassical economic theory that is taught in most economics departments, the goal of government policy is simply to correct market failures. In this view, once the sources of failure have been addressed, a monopoly reined in, a public good subsidized, or a negative externality taxed, market forces will efficiently allocate resources, enabling the economy to follow a path to growth. But that view forgets that markets are blind, so to speak. They may neglect societal or environmental concerns, and they often head in suboptimal, path-dependent directions that are self-reinforcing. Energy companies, for example, would rather invest in extracting oil from the deepest confines of the earth than in clean energy. In other words, our energy system moves along a carbon-intensive path that was set up more than a century ago. This is not just about market failure. It's about the wrong kind of market getting stuck. The path-dependent direction that the economy follows under free market conditions is problematic, particularly when the world is confronted with great societal challenges such as climate change, youth unemployment, obesity, aging, and inequality. In addressing these challenges, the state must lead, not by simply fixing market failures, but by actively creating and shaping new markets while regulating existing ones. It must direct the economy towards new techno-economic paradigms, in the words of the technology and innovation scholar Carlotta Perez. Usually, these directions are not generated spontaneously from market forces. They are largely the result of strategic public sector decision-making. Indeed, nearly all of the technological revolutions in the past, from the internet to today's green tech revolution, required a massive push by the state. Silicon Valley's techno-libertarians might be surprised to find out that Uncle Sam funded many of the innovations behind the information technology revolution. The iPhone is often heralded as the quintessential example of what happens when a hands-off government allows genius entrepreneurs to flourish. And yet, the development of the features that make the iPhone a smartphone rather than a stupid phone was publicly funded. The iPhone depends on the internet. The progenitor of the internet was ARPANET, a program funded in the 1960s by the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, DARPA, which is part of the Defense Department. The Global Positioning System, GPS, began as a 1970s U.S. military program called Navstar. The iPhone's touchscreen technology was created by the company Fingerworks, which was founded by a professor at the publicly funded University of Delaware and one of his doctoral candidates, who received grants from the National Science Foundation and the CIA. Even Siri, the iPhone's cheery, voice-recognizing personal assistant, can trace its lineage to the U.S. government. It is a spin-off of a DARPA artificial intelligence project. And this is not just about the military-industrial complex. It is just as true in health and energy. As the physician Marcia Angel has shown, many of the most promising new drugs trace their origins to research done by the taxpayer-funded National Institutes of Health, NIH, which has an annual budget of some $30 billion. Private pharmaceutical companies, meanwhile, tend to focus more on the D than the R part of R&D, and some slight variations of existing drugs and marketing. And more recently, despite the myths about the shale gas boom being driven by wildcatting entrepreneurs operating independently from the state, the U.S. federal government invested heavily in the technologies that unleashed it. When in 1976 the Morgantown Energy Research Center, owned and operated by the U.S. Department of Energy, and the Bureau of Mines launched the Eastern Gas Shales Project, which demonstrated how natural gas could be recovered from shale formations, the federal government opened the Gas Research Institute, funded through a tax on natural gas production, and spent billions of dollars on research into shale gas. In this same period, the Sandia National Laboratories, also part of the U.S. Department of Energy, developed the 3D geologic mapping technology used for fracking operations. The story of state-funded energy innovation is being repeated today, not just in renewable energy, but even in the green companies themselves. Tesla Motors, SolarCity, and SpaceX, all led by entrepreneur Elon Musk, are currently surfing a new wave of state technology. Together, these high-tech ventures have benefited from $4.9 billion in local, state, and federal government support, such as grants, tax breaks, investments in factory construction, and subsidized loans. The state also forges demand, creates the market for their products by granting tax credits and rebates to consumers for solar panels and electric vehicles, and by contracting $5.5 billion worth of procurement contracts with SpaceX and $5.5 billion for the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, NASA, and the U.S. Air Force. While some of this governmental support has recently been the focus of news articles, two things have passed relatively unnoticed. First, that Tesla Motors also benefited from a massive publicly funded guaranteed loan of $465 million. Secondly, Tesla, SolarCity, and SpaceX have also benefited from direct investments in radical technologies by the U.S. Department of Energy, in the case of battery technologies and solar panels, and by NASA, in the case of rocket technologies. Technologies that SpaceX is now using in its business dealings with the International Space Station. This shouldn't come as a surprise. The state has been behind the development of many key technologies that are later integrated by the private sector into breakthrough innovations. These companies are, of course, helping to push the innovation frontier by further developing state-funded technologies and, crucially, contributing to a transition to a more environmentally sustainable economy. But all we hear in the media is the one-sided myth of the lone entrepreneur. The role of the state is massive, not only on the supply side, but also on the demand side. That is, the deployment and diffusion of new technologies. Even in cases where private markets seem to play a leading role, such as in the automobile revolution, it was the state that established the enabling conditions for car diffusion. New street regulations, road construction works, licensing and traffic rules, etc. In the mass production revolution, for instance, the state invested in both the underlying technologies and their diffusion across the economy. On the supply side, defense investments in the United States, beginning in World War II, led to improvements in aerospace, electronics, and materials. On the demand side, the U.S. government's post-World War II subsidization of suburban living by building roads, backing mortgages, and guaranteeing incomes through the welfare state enabled workers to own homes, buy cars, and consume other mass-produced goods. And today, more of Tesla's electric cars are sold in Norway than in the United States due to the Norwegian government's policies stimulating the purchase of green products. Supply-side support from the U.S. government, demand-side support by the Norwegian government. Hardly a lone entrepreneur. For policymakers, then, the question should not be whether to pick winners or not. Everything of relevance has been picked, from the internet to fracking technology. What should become more central to the policy debate is how to pick broadly defined directions within which bottom-up experimentation can take place. But private investments will only kick in after those directions have been picked, creating expectations in business about future growth opportunities in particular areas. Such directionality will, of course, involve some failures here and there, but the advantages that result from those supply-side and demand-side pushes will be more than worth the wait, creating decades of growth. Rather, the question should be how to do so in a way that is democratically accountable and that solves the most pressing social and technological challenges. Evaluating public policies. Indeed, state spending on innovation tends to be assessed in exactly the wrong way. Under the prevailing economic framework, market failures are identified and particular government investments are proposed. Their value is then appraised through a narrow calculation that involves heavy guesswork. Will the benefits of a particular intervention exceed the costs associated with both the offending market failure and the implementation of the fix, i.e., costs associated with possible government failures? Such a method is far too static to evaluate something as dynamic as innovation. By failing to account for the possibility that the state can create economic and technological opportunities that never existed before, and take massive risks in doing so, it gives short shrift to government's efforts in this area. No wonder economists often characterize the public sector as nothing more than an inefficient version of the private sector. This incomplete way of measuring public investment leads to accusations that by entering certain sectors, governments are crowding out the private investment. Instead, the truth is that government investment often has the effect of crowding in, meaning that it stimulates private investment that would otherwise not have happened, and in so doing expands the overall pie of national output, which benefits both private and public investors. But more important, public investments should aim not only to kickstart the economy, but also, and possibly more importantly, to do things that are not even envisioned and therefore not done at all. No private companies were trying to put a man on the moon when NASA undertook the Apollo project, which resulted not only in the accomplishment of the mission, but in many breakthroughs that make up what we today call the information and communication technological revolution. Currently, private companies like Elon Musk's SpaceX and Jeff Bezos's of Amazon Blue Origin are drawing on NASA's technology shelves and benefiting from the agency's procurement contracts to explore low Earth orbit and the space beyond. As I have emphasized in a recent project commissioned by NASA, publication forthcoming, on the emerging low Earth orbit economy, the danger is that we socialize the risks of space exploration, but once again let the rewards of the venture be privatized. This can put future innovation at risk, as the state agencies responsible for innovation do not share in the rewards. Creating a symbiotic, more mutualistic public-private innovation ecosystem thus requires new methods, metrics, and indicators to evaluate public investments and their results. Without the right tools for evaluating investments, governments have a hard time knowing when they are merely operating in existing spaces and when they are making things happen that would not have happened otherwise. The result? Investments that are too narrow, constrained by the prevailing path-dependent techno-economic paradigm. A better way of evaluating a given investment would be to consider the different types of spillovers, including the creation of new skills and capabilities, and whether it led to the creation of new technologies, sectors, and markets. When it comes to government spending on life sciences and health research, for example, it might make sense to move past the private pharmaceutical sector's fixation on drugs and fund more work on diagnostics, surgical treatments, and lifestyle changes. Key overlooked areas that offer great potential to improve the world population's health condition. Building dynamic public organizations. Governments suffer from another related problem when it comes to contemplating investment. As a result of the dominant view that they should stick to fixing market failures, they are often ill-equipped to do much more than that. To avoid such problems as a regulatory agency getting captured by business, the thinking goes the state must insulate itself from the private sector. That's why governments have increasingly outsourced key jobs to the private sector. But that trend often rids them of the knowledge necessary for devising a smart strategy for transforming the particular agency into one that can attract top talent. It creates a self-fulfilling prophecy. The less big thinking a government does, the less expertise it is able to attract, the worse it performs, and the less big thinking it is allowed to do and capable of doing. Had there been more information technology capacity within the U.S. government, the Obama administration would probably not have had such difficulty rolling out healthcare.gov, yet that failure will likely lead to only more outsourcing. In order to create and shape technologies, sectors, and markets, the state must be armed with the intelligence necessary to envision and enact bold policies. This does not mean that the state will always succeed. Indeed, the uncertainty inherent in the innovation process means that it will often fail. But it needs to learn from failed investments and continuously improve its structures and practices. As the economist Albert Hirschman emphasized, the policy-making process is, by its nature, messy, so it is important for public institutions to welcome the process of trial and error. Governments should pay as much attention to the business school topics of strategic management and organizational behavior as private companies do. Yet, by dismissing the role of the public sector as not important, the focus inevitably is not on making the government more competent and smarter, but on making it smaller or absent entirely. Indeed, the desire to make things happen that otherwise would not requires not just bureaucratic skills, though these are critical, as pointed out by Max Weber, but real technology-specific and sector-specific expertise. It is only through an exciting vision of the state's role that such expertise can be recruited, and it is then able to map out the landscape in the relevant space. Indeed, it is not a coincidence that the Department of Energy, which played a critical role in the 2009 U.S. stimulus program, was run by Nobel Prize-winning physicist Stephen Chu. Risks and rewards. Admitting the role of the state as lead risk-taker and innovator means also admitting the massive risks it must take under extreme uncertainty and hence the high probability of failure. This requires a particular type of deal between business and the state that recognizes that since the public sector often undertakes courageous spending during the riskiest parts of the innovation process, it is only fair that it not only pick up the bill during the downside, but also make something on the upside. That is, socialize both risks and rewards. The U.S. Small Business Innovation Research, SBIR program, for example, offers high-risk financing to companies at much earlier stages than most private venture capital firms do. It funded Compaq and Intel when they were startups. Similarly, the Small Business Investment Company program, an initiative under the auspices of the U.S. Small Business Administration, has provided crucial loans and grants to early-stage companies, including Apple in 1978, discussed in Chapter 8. In fact, the need for such long-term investments has only increased over time as venture capital firms have become more short-term in their outlook, emphasizing finding an exit for each of their investments, usually through a public offering or a sale to another company, within 3 years. Real innovation can take decades. And here, it is fundamental to remember, it is in the nature of early-stage investing in technologies with uncertain prospects that some investments will be winners while many others will be losers. For every internet, a success story of U.S. government financing, there are many Concords, a white elephant funded by the British and French governments, including the failed American Supersonic Transport Project. Consider the twin tales of Solyndra and Tesla Motors. In 2009, Solyndra, a solar-powered panel startup, received a $535 million guaranteed loan from the Department of Energy. That same year, Tesla, the electric car manufacturer, got approval for a similar loan for $465 million. In the years afterward, Tesla was to a great degree successful, and the firm repaid its loan in 2013. Solyndra, by contrast, filed for bankruptcy in 2011 and, among fiscal conservatives, became a byword for the government's sorry track record when it comes to picking winners. Of course, if the government is to act like a venture capitalist, it will necessarily encounter many failures. The problem, however, is that governments, unlike venture capital firms, are often saddled with the costs of the failures while earning next to nothing from the successes. Taxpayers footed the bill for Solyndra's losses, yet got hardly any of Tesla's profits. Economists may argue that the state already receives a return on its investments by taxing the resulting profits. The truth is more complicated. Large corporations are masters of tax evasion. Google, whose game-changing search algorithm was developed with funding from the National Science Foundation, has lowered its U.S. tax bill by funneling some of its profits through Ireland. Apple does the same by taking advantage of a race to the bottom among U.S. states. In 2006, the company, which is based in Cupertino, California, set up an investment subsidiary in Reno, Nevada, to save money. This is why proposals for increasing the wealth tax as a way to curb inequality and generate cash for the state to invest in the innovation and economic process, such as put forth by the French economist Thomas Piketty, are not enough. Bolder and more creative proposals are needed. Fixing the problem is not just a matter of fixing the loopholes. Tax rates in the United States and other Western countries have been falling over the past several decades precisely due to an errant narrative about how the private sector serves as the sole wealth creator. Government revenues have also shrunk due to tax incentives aimed at promoting innovation, few of which have been shown to produce any R&D that would not have happened otherwise. And capital is more mobile than ever. A particular government that has funded a given company might not be able to tax it since it may have moved abroad. And although taxes are effective at paying for the basics, such as education, healthcare, and research, they don't begin to cover the cost of making direct investments in companies or specific technologies. If the state is being asked to make such investments, as will increasingly be the case as financial markets become even more focused on the short term, then it should be allowed to recover the inevitable losses that arise from this process. Had the U.S. government had a stake in Tesla, it would have been able to more than cover its losses from Solyndra. The year Tesla received its government loan, the company went public at an opening price of $17 a share. That figure had risen to $93 by the time the loan was repaid. In 2013, shares in Tesla traded above $200. Today, it is priced slightly below this level. The prospect of the state owning a stake in a private corporation may be anathema to many parts of the capitalist world, But given that governments are already investing in the private sector, they may as well earn a return on those investments, something even fiscal conservatives might find attractive. The state need not hold a controlling stake, but it could hold equity in the form of preferred stocks that get priority in receiving dividends. As usual, caution with political vested interests would be needed in setting up such a scheme. The returns could be used to fund future innovation. There are, of course, other ways in which we can socialize not only the risks but also the rewards of innovation, as discussed in Chapter 9. The main point here being that politicians, economists, and the media have been too quick to criticize public investments when things go wrong and too slow to reward them when things go right. Secular stagnation is not inevitable. Today, we are in the midst of an economic stagnation that some, like American economist Larry Summers, call secular stagnation, which implies that a long-term period of near-zero growth rates is inevitable and persistent. But this somewhat doom-laden diagnosis misses the underlying causes of the disease. The causes are not the exhaustion of profitable technological opportunities or a lack of effective demand per se, declining levels of income per capita. The fundamental causes are related to what the state is doing, or better, what it is not doing. Arresting this drift into secular stagnation requires policies that aim at smart, innovation-led growth and inclusive growth at the same time. It requires the state to think big. It has, however, become harder and harder for governments to do so for the reasons I have described. The notion of the state as a mere facilitator, administrator, and regulator may have first started to gain widespread currency in the 1970s, but it has taken on newfound popularity in the wake of the global financial crisis. Overlooking that it was private debt and speculation that led to the meltdown, across the globe, policymakers have targeted public debt, arguing that cutting government spending will spur private investment. As a result, the very state agencies, such as DARPA and the NIH in the United States, that have been responsible for the technological revolutions of the past, have seen their budgets shrink. In the United States, the budget sequestration process, which was signed into law in 2011 by a Democratic president and Democrat-controlled Senate, will result in $95 billion worth of cuts to federal R&D spending from 2013 to 2021. In Europe, the European Union's fiscal compact, which requires states to drop their fiscal deficits down to 3% of GDP, is squeezing education and R&D spending. On top of this, we are witnessing an increased financialization of the business sector, with many companies spending more on share buybacks to boost their stock prices, stock options, and executive pay than on areas like human capital and R&D. As the work of Lozanic has shown, in the last decade, nearly $4 trillion has been spent on share buybacks by Fortune 500 companies. The companies leading in the share buybacks in pharmaceuticals and energy claim this practice is due to there being no opportunities for investment. Yet it is clear this is far from reality when we witness the billions being poured into renewable energy and pharmaceutical innovation through public sector organizations. So the problem is not one about short-termism, but also about the way in which we have not struck the right deal between government and business. In the end, an increasingly timid and sometimes austerity-driven public sector and an increasingly financialized business sector will surely get us secular stagnation. But that is our choice, and we can go into reverse gear. A new language and rhetoric. While innovation is not the state's main role, illustrating its potential innovative and dynamic character, its historical ability in some countries to play an entrepreneurial role in society, is perhaps the most effective way to defend its existence and size in a proactive way. To change the way we talk about the state is not just about changing rhetoric. It is about changing the way we reason about the state, its role, and its structure. The way I interpret Jutt's challenge is that we must start using new words to describe the state. Crowding in is a concept that, while defending the public sector, is still using the negative as a benchmark. The possibility that government investment crowds out private investment by competing for the same limited amount of savings. If we want to describe something positive and visionary, a word that is bolder and offensive, not defensive, should be used. Rather than analyzing the state's active role through its correction of market failures, emphasized by many progressive economists who rightly see many failures, it is necessary to build a theory of the state's role in shaping and creating markets, more in line with the work of Carl Polanyi, who emphasized how the capitalist market has, from the start, been heavily shaped by state actions. In innovation, the state not only crowds in business investment, but also dynamizes it in, creating the vision, the mission, and the plan. The book offers a new way of talking and thinking about the state, in order to expand our vision of what it can do. It takes on Jutt's discursive battle, from an inertial bureaucratic leviathan to the very catalyst for new business investment, from market fixer to market shaper and creator, from simply de-risking the private sector to welcoming and taking on risk due to the opportunities it presents for future growth, against all odds. Structure of the book. The book is structured as follows. Chapter 1 begins by.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.